Welcome to The Art of Living Big. I'm your host, Betsy Paik. I'm an author, a speaker, a master hypnotherapist, an NLP coach, and I help high achievers rewire for success. If you're ready for the next level, you're in the right place. Over the next 30 minutes, I hope to help you redefine what could be possible for your life. Now, let's go live big. Hey, everyone. So today I have a really special guest on the show. My daughter, Olive, has come on the show. And I wanted to say a couple things before we dive into this episode. It's an episode about mental health, and it's about our personal journey with mental health. You know, this episode, Olive and I have talked on and off about her coming on the show. She's a very deep thinker. Like, I think she could come on the show and we could have some really deep discussions about the world and the universe and all things political. And like, I mean, we could dive into a lot of things. She's super smart and like very thoughtful. And so I do want to make the point that it was her idea to come on and talk about her mental illness. Now, I've mentioned before on the show things like, you know, when my daughter was sick or those kinds of things, because it is part of my story too. But this specific version, what we shared today is hers. It's her story. And so I wanted to make sure that you knew that it was her idea. I mean, she's an adult, she's 19, but it was her idea. She wanted to share it. She feels like perhaps the story and what we went through might help somebody not feel so alone, and also maybe give somebody ideas if they're struggling with somebody else in their family or someone that they love that has a mental illness, and also to normalize it a little bit. You know, it's not like shameful or bad. It's something that we have gone through and that we're dealing with. A couple other things that I want to say is that we talk a little bit on the show about medication and also about not taking medication. And if you are in this world of like mental health, then you know there's like a lot of very passionate sides to that equation. And I just want to ask that, you know, it was a choice that we made, and you'll hear us talk about it, but a choice that we made that was not an easy choice, but it was a life-saving choice. And so I just want to say that many times I'll get emails about shows, and I love that. I love the feedback, even the feedback that's not positive. I like hearing how it made you shift or think or like take into account your feelings on it. And this is going to be one show that I'm just going to ask that I'm not looking for any advice. And that's kind of hard for me to say because I always want feedback. But in this particular case, you know, what we talk about on this show, you'll hear is very dramatic, and it's not even a sliver of what we went through. And so I have heard every piece of advice, and you know, we have explored probably any option that you could think of. And so I just ask that with respect, that we've been through so much. It's just an episode for us to tell our version of the story. And we're not doctors, so this isn't any kind of medical advice or suggestions for you. It's just our story. The last thing that I want to point out, and I didn't realize it until I struggled a little bit with having her come on because she's 19, she's an adult, but a lot of things about our brain are not fully formed until we're 24, 25. And part of that is there's a consequence piece. And so I wanted to listen to it again before I put it together to air it, because I wanted to make sure I wanted to protect her. You know, there's a little bit of a scary thing of sharing all of this too. But when I went through it and listened, one of the things that I noticed, and this is something I'm really happy about, and so I want to point it out, because if you've been here for a while listening to the show, you know that I love language and words, and how we say the words creates our reality. And one of the things you'll hear her talk about, how I have depression. She doesn't say, I am depressed. And as I listened through, sometimes when she talks about it, and even when I talk about it, we talk about it. It's not, it's separate from her. And when I went through and listened, it has become so natural to us. But I remember there was a time where that was a fight, where I would say, don't say it like that. And so now that has become just part of how we talk. And I wanted to just point that out because I think it's a really good takeaway for me after I listened to the show again. So anyway, I'm really delighted to introduce you to my daughter and to have you share in this show. So thank you so much for being here and thanks for listening. Let's go to the show. Hello, fellow adventurers. Welcome to today's show. So today I'm really excited because I have a special guest that is very near and dear to my heart. In fact, she has been closest to my heart than anyone else on the planet. So, Olive, welcome to the show. Tell everybody about you and who you are.
Hi, I'm Betsy's daughter. I'm Olive. I don't know what to say. What do I say about myself?
Well, you're 19.
I'm 19.
And you
I'm
go to
Aquarius. I like long walks on the beach.
Who loves the beach more, you or me?
Definitely mom. Mom.
Yeah. So we were talking last night. So Olive and I last night were having like this big conversation. We FaceTime all the time.
We FaceTime like 4 times a day.
Yeah, at least. Yeah. Like we get ready together. we're always on FaceTime. So we were FaceTiming last night. And we had been sharing pieces of a podcast where you explain what was happening in the podcast.
Basically, the guy's name is Duncan, who runs the podcast. I forget the exact name of the podcast, but his mother was dying from like a breast bone cancer. And she was on the podcast with him and they were just talking about life and death and the implications of dying
and how it feels. And we had listened to one episode earlier. And then this episode that we listened to, we both listened to it last night. And then we kept like calling each other in the middle and talking about it.
Yeah. So good.
It's so good. And this particular episode, she was getting even closer to death and she was saying how she could feel this vastness and she could feel herself being held. And anyway, as Olive and I started talking, I realized that we have these very deep conversations a lot and that it might be fun to have Olive come on and talk, not only like the deep conversations, but also Olive has a very interesting story of her own that I believe that story could help other people. And yes, so very, I thought maybe we could talk about all that. But having deep conversations is like nothing new with you and me.
No, I think all of our conversations are deep in their own special way.
Yeah.
That's how we communicate. So deep, meaningful conversations.
Do you feel like even when you were younger, we would have deep conversations? Like when did deep conversations start?
I think they started when I was like 12.
Yeah.
When I was like old enough to like actually form deep conversations. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I think when you're younger, you can have deep conversations, but it's just in a less organized way.
It's in a different kind of way.
Yeah. Like I feel like I have deep conversations with my half siblings, Emma and Jordan, who are 8 and 6 now. And they have deep conversations, but it's in a very broken up way because they don't have the words to explain the thoughts that they're having all the time.
Yeah. 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 You know, one of the things we were talking about last night, because as a parent, I feel like I have always treated you not as an adult. I don't mean that, but with a certain level of respect that you would understand. Like I never felt like I was ever really treating you like a kid. I might have been treating you like age appropriately, but never like you were.
You never talked down to me.
No. Yeah. That was always a big thing with me. that I would answer you honestly, but age appropriately for everything you asked.
Yes.
And was that hard when you were younger? Like having, you know, there's a lot, everybody that's listening is like me, but you didn't have a lot of friends that had parents like me.
No, I think I grew up going to like a little Christian private school. And so all of my friends' moms were like stay at home, Christian, very conservative mothers. And so to see the difference between my friends' mothers and then my mom, who was like super cool.
But did you always think it was super cool, or was it hard?
No, it was definitely hard because I sort of wanted you to be normal and you weren't super normal. Which my normal, you think normal would be what you grow up with. But for me, growing up in like this small Christian church, what my normal was what everyone else's normal was, which was like the housewife, stay-at-home mom. And so I would go over to my friend's house and their moms would be like conservative Christian, making food. Like that was the way, like they would have live, laugh, love signs on their walls. And it just was very conservative. And then my mom is very liberal and very like, she had a pink van at one point that was wrapped and said, what did it say on it?
Big ass van.
Yeah, so she would pull up in her pink van and I'd be like a little embarrassed because she was so different. And
it had kettlebells all over it. So it's at the time where I was doing like outdoor like boot camps and stuff. I owned a little business where I had coaches that worked for me and they would take the van that would be full of gear, but it was covered. I had it wrapped right in pink with kettlebells and it said bigassvan.com.
Yeah.
So I would pull up to the Christian school to pick you up.
In the big ass van.
But your friends, did your friends like it or did your friends not like that?
I think my friends liked it, but didn't know why they liked it.
Yeah. Something about it felt good, but it felt very different.
Very different.
They should like it.
Yes.
I remember you having events at school and you would say, can you just come dressed like a mom? Like, just come like a normal mom.
Yeah.
And I was like, I am a normal mom. And you would look at me and I just remember one time in particular and you were like, and it was those socks that we talked about last night.
Yeah.
So
she had these socks that pointed up to her butt that said, what did they say on them?
They said badass
and they pointed up to her butt.
The thing was, at the time I owned a CrossFit gym. So when I would go to pick you up or go to the school for something, I would be like in workout stuff. And you know, CrossFitters wear those socks they pull up to their knees because of the bar. Mm-hmm. And so it was all, I could tell that there was a lot of things I did that were cringy. So like that was one side of it. And then the other side was sort of this, what you called last night, hippy dippy side.
Yes. Very spiritual, hippy dippy. And that's always how I would explain it to my friends, is she's very hippy dippy. And that would sort of get the idea across of what they were getting themselves into, being my friend, of like, you're going to have some crazy.
Right.
And very spiritual and fun.
So when you were growing up, there was part of you that liked it. And there was part of you that really longed for what everybody else had. And I remember there was a period of time where you wanted to go to the neighbors for dinner a lot. Did I lose you?
Yes. Nope. We're good.
Okay. So there was a time
Dad called.
Okay. Ooh, it's like the first time you didn't hang up on me for Dad. So I remember there was a period of time where you wanted to go to the neighbors for dinner, like a lot, like every night you were going to the neighbors for dinner. And you said to me, her mom's a normal mom. And I remember at first being like hurt about it, but then I realized I didn't have to feed you if you were gone. Yeah. I don't have to figure out what to feed everybody. If you're gone, I can just be like ketchup packets for Craig, you know? So. Yeah. So it was sort of a little bit of a different kind of upbringing than what you were seeing on the outside.
Yes. Everyone else had very conservative, is just the best word to use for it, mothers. And I had a very hippy dippy, loving, warm, welcoming mother who was very different from everyone else.
I remember once you had a sleepover and all the kids were standing around the kitchen island, and I went around the island and told them all the things I thought were cool about them. Mm-hmm. And you guys were like in seventh grade or something. And I remember they all looked at me like, I like this and this is so weird.
Yeah.
So all of that, just to kind of set up the, I guess, set up the like background for other things in your life. So what else? What else is like, I don't want to use the word different, but what other things have happened that you think you've learned a lot or people could learn from you? Because I think you're really incredible. Like, you've been through a lot and you're really awesome and resilient.
Thank you. I went through a lot of mental illness. Mm-hmm. I think my mental illness started when I was really young, probably like six, I would say.
What makes you say that? Why? What makes you say six?
I say six because that's when I remember being like uncomfortable with stuff. Like, I used to have a lot of issues with clothing. Mm-hmm. And I had just a lot of issues with clothing and with being around people and being around loud noises and a lot of anxiety just around everything.
Yeah. I remember clothing specifically. How would you describe? It was like a sensory.
It was just a sensory thing, super uncomfortable, especially the arms of clothing. If it was too tight, mm-hmm. like you'll see those cute shirts that have like the bubble,
sleeves,
bubble sleeves, and they cinch at the bottom. And that would bother me so much. The cinching, it was like this little plastic band that would cinch the arm. And it was so uncomfortable to me.
Yeah. And socks. I remember you had a hard time with socks.
I had a terrible time with socks. I remember when I played soccer, socks were a really difficult thing for me because we had thick wool socks that we wore for soccer.
Yeah.
And those that was, were like,
and that was age four.
Yeah, age four. So even earlier, I think I was born with mental illness. Just
so tell me what you, when you say mental illness, what, how would, how, what's your definition of that?
I think my definition of mental illness is, for me, my anxiety, my depression that I've struggled with later on in life. I don't think I really had depression when I was four, but definitely just sick, and sick in a way that was just tiring and just sad, just sadness.
Yeah.
Growing up.
I remember years later, and we'll get to that, but years later, I found some art you had drawn and letters you had written, and it was very, very sad and scary to find.
Yes.
So you feel like this started, maybe you were born with it and you'd had it forever. And it started when you were younger, more like sensory stuff. Then it got, when would you say that it expanded and got to where it was like harder to do things?
I'd say around 12, mm-hmm. probably like when puberty started, that's when my depression really started and my anxiety became like an unbearable sort of shadow.
Yeah. Yeah. And really not even a shadow. It became the forefront of your life and the focus for many years.
Yeah, it consumed me for sure.
Yeah. Can you tell people a little bit about what happened and how you experienced that?
How would I describe? I want to sort of keep it as linear as possible. But when I was 12, I remember it was really difficult to make friends because of my anxiety. And also it was unbearable to be around people, and around noise was a big thing for me. Like I didn't want to make any noise. And if there was too many noises, it was a lot for me to handle.
Yeah.
It wasn't the volume of the noise. It was how many different noises were going on. So if like five people were talking at once, it became really difficult for me to handle because I wanted to listen up to everything, but my brain couldn't handle it.
Yeah. Yeah. And so what would happen when too many noises would be happening?
Usually I would just cry. That was sort of my first stop, was just to cry, because you get all this anxiety and it builds up. And you want to get it out physically. And my way to get it out physically was just to cry.
Right.
So I would if I was at school, I would go to the bathroom and cry and just like get it out. And then I would go back to class and try to be as normal as possible.
And I know lots of times when you would go into the bathroom, you'd call me.
Yes. Yes.
And that was like, I would say like sixth, seventh grade, probably when that really started.
Yes, for sure.
So now you're in school, right? Yes. Seventh grade, you're having all of this stuff happen. You're feeling tons of anxiety. It's making you depressed. It's making you hard to have friends because you were the kid that would go in the bathroom and cry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so very difficult.
And so then kind of how, like, bring me all the way up to speed, like go through like an overview of kind of how it manifested.
You mean when I'm in sixth, seventh grade or as I got older?
Like as you got older. So it started like that. So let's think of it in terms of like somebody listening and they have a kid that's sixth, seventh grade and they're starting to see this.
Yes.
I think that one of the things we can do today is just to share your journey, I think could be really powerful for somebody else to just hear.
Of course.
And also as we're going through, I believe that I did the very best I could with what I knew at the time, but also I think it made it harder because I was so upbeat.
Yes.
So then it was like, go ahead.
I wanted someone to be in the hurt with me.
Yeah.
And even though that's really difficult and probably not the right thing.
That's a natural thing, I think, though. Yeah.
Yeah. You want people to hurt with you and you want someone to understand the pain that you're going through. Because it was painful, the anxiety and the depression. It was like almost physically painful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was all consuming. It never stopped. I would lay up in bed and cry for hours,
mm-hmm.
just trying to fall asleep and just not happy with my life or where I was.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there was nothing wrong in my life, which made it even more difficult to explain and understand because I wasn't like abused as a kid. I wasn't, I didn't have an eating disorder. There was no like terrible thing going on.
Right.
But it was just this anxiety and this depression that.
Well, the anxiety and the depression was the terrible thing.
Yeah, it was the terrible thing.
But you were looking for some other reason besides.
Yeah, I was looking for the depression and anxiety to be the effect of some cause.
Yeah.
When really it was the cause.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So then you get into high school. What happens?
Then I get into high school and I cannot keep my grades up. I cannot keep friends. I have one friend named Abby, who is my bestest friend.
Yeah.
And she's
one of our neighbors.
One of our neighbors. And I couldn't keep my grades up. I couldn't function. I would go to class and I would not do the work because I didn't understand how to do the work with how much pain I was feeling. I don't know how to explain it other than there was so much pain going on in everywhere that it was impossible to
do work.
Focus on anything else. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, go ahead.
So usually I would just go to the bathroom and cry and call my mom and ask her to pick me up and like beg for her to help me in some way. And it was really difficult.
And throughout all of this, you were going to therapy,
right? Yes. Like, not like we were just ignoring, like not getting help. Yeah, you had a lot of help. And even in sixth grade, you had a lot of help at the school.
Yes.
We had special help for you in terms of your classes. You were on an IEP, so you got extra time with things. So there was a lot of services and stuff on the back end going on while all this was going on.
Yes. Yet
it felt like it didn't matter. It was still so all encompassing that it just didn't matter. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. We got so much help and nothing was doing what it needed to do. And it just was very difficult. And then I was on medication. I was on a medication called Zoloft. Mm-hmm. And this Zoloft, I was on for probably like how long was I on that? Would you say?
Maybe a year. We tried like a lot of different diets and stuff to help you too. Like 30, we did a lot of stuff to try and help, like, and tried not to do medication. Cause for me, I had a lot of fear around our young brain being on medication. But then we realized it was a matter of life or death. But
yes,
you get help. So you were on Zoloft for about a year. I would say like 10 months, maybe.
Yeah. And the Zoloft was going fine. And then we upped the Zoloft because it wasn't doing what it was supposed to be doing. And so the doctor tried to up it. And that gave me like horrific nightmares, the Zoloft. Once it got to the amount of Zoloft that I was taking. So I was taking a little bit and then they upped the amount of medication that I was taking. And that's when these nightmares started.
I wouldn't even call them nightmares. I feel like they were hallucinations. Like it was.
Do you think they were hallucinations?
Well, you were awake.
Yes.
These experiences.
Yes.
So it wasn't really a nightmare because you weren't asleep. You were awake.
Yes.
It was more like a hellish hallucination.
Yes. And they would happen at night.
In the middle of the night.
And I would stay up until they happened because I didn't want to fall asleep. And then I would get zero sleep because I was going through this terrible.
So I feel like you were on the Zoloft for like 10 months, but I feel like they upped it. Like maybe like at 3 months or something. And so there was a whole period of time, like say 6 months, seven months where you were having these hallucinations, but you didn't tell anybody.
Yes. I didn't tell anyone. And I think the reason I didn't tell anyone is because I just thought that I was crazy. Mm-hmm. I just thought that.
You thought it was like part of you going nuts that you were like.
Yeah. I thought I was just delusional and crazy. And
the hallucinations you were having were not easy to watch.
No, it was like watching friends die. It was hurting myself. It was like every worst fear that you can have wrapped into a delusion.
Yeah.
And I can go more into depth of those if you want.
And that was like what, sophomore year?
Yeah, sophomore year.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, if you want to talk about those more, I know for me, this is when things got on my side of this equation. Yeah. Like always there was this like worry and concern. Like my whole life, I knew you had some kind of level of anxiety. I remember you being 2 years old and in the car seat and watching you go, like take a big breath like that.
Take a big breath.
And I remember thinking like, she's stressed. And you were like maybe two.
Yeah.
So like, I really feel like you were born with this. And to jump all the way back, just from my perspective, I had a really bad pregnancy. It was not an easy pregnancy. Mm-hmm. And I felt really strange during my pregnancy. And the only way I could describe it is like, my face would go red when I would talk, like I would be embarrassed. I felt really self-conscious. I felt like all of these things that I think you were feeling. I think you were feeling that inside the womb. Yeah. And I was experiencing it. I know that sounds a little weird, but because then immediately you were stressed and yes. had anxiety. And so then all through this, we were trying to get help. I mean, it was very, very stressful. And I know your perspective is like, mom was always super happy and upbeat. Like we talked about that a little bit mm-hmm. last night. And I think that's sort of my disposition, but there was a side of me that was like, I didn't know what to do. Like I was trying everything. So there was a part of me by this point that was becoming quite desperate.
Yes.
So you
just
start
watching
having,
it happen and yes. not knowing what to do.
And like I would say, you know, if you had a broken leg, I'd bring you to the doctor and then the doctor would be like, oh, she has a broken leg. We do this and this and this, and then you'd be fine. Yep. But with this, we went to a lot of doctors and
a lot of doctors.
I don't know that we went to a lot of good doctors. It took a while to find good doctors.
Yeah, it's very difficult to find like a perfect doctor for your situation.
And one that like actually listens and doesn't like just want to throw medication at it.
Yes.
So, all right. So now you're having these hallucinations. Do you want to talk any more about those? Because I think that kind of leads into what we do next.
Yeah, of course. We can talk about the hallucinations. I had a friend who was transgender and he was like a good friend of mine. And I had this dream that people would just beat him up and he would die from these beatings.
Yeah.
I still remember it vividly of like how like they would break his jaw, they would break his arm in two places, his wrist in three, break his nose, break his jaw, and then they would break his ribs and his ribs would puncture his organs, and then that is how he would die. And he would die looking at me mm-hmm. and just like screaming.
Yeah.
And so to watch that every night for like a year
yeah
is really difficult.
And in isolation, because you were afraid to tell somebody.
Yeah.
We're experiencing all this in isolation. So you'd be up all night. So then in the morning when I'd wake you up for school at 5:15, because your school bus came yeah. super early, which most of the time I drove you, but
yeah,
what would happen?
I would wake up. I probably got like 3 hours of sleep each night. Like yeah. genuinely, like I did not sleep because I would stay awake through these hallucinations and then I would just cry myself to sleep.
Yeah.
And so that was probably, I mean, maybe like 5 hours a night, 5 to 2. I was getting no sleep.
Yeah.
And that, of course, made everything worse because you need sleep to survive. Totally. And I wasn't getting the sleep that I needed.
You'd have hallucinations just from not having enough sleep.
Yeah, probably.
You can have that. So
yeah.
makes sense. This would be aggravating the whole thing. So this goes on. Now you're in your sophomore year. You won't get up for school. I bring you to school lots of times. I drive you, which is a hellish drive because there's yeah. you go to this school where there's 4,000 kids. And so it's like a traffic jam. It takes like an hour to get like yeah. the half a mile to school or whatever.
Yeah.
And then if I drop you off, then you're immediately you're calling me to come get you.
Yes. Immediately. Like I would go in and I would see how many people there were and I would just freak out and go to the bathrooms and try to get help.
Yeah.
Through mom. And it was just really difficult to get through.
Yeah.
Just the amount of people all crammed together in a lunchroom.
Yeah.
It was really difficult to see and experience.
Yeah.
And so nothing was working. I was very sick. And then I eventually told my mom, I broke down and I told my mom about the hallucinations. And I just said, like, this is what's been happening. I don't know how to handle it. This is why I'm not. This is why I would take naps when I got home from school.
Well, you would come home from school like around 9:30.
Yeah.
Right. Like, I mean, almost yes. every day you were calling or the school was calling and like, I would just yeah. barely get home and then you'd be calling. And so for me, it was like, she's got to go to school. Like she's not going to school. Like I was yes. like, what happens if you don't go to school?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, and then one day you came downstairs. Can I tell this from
Yeah, of course. Go for it.
So So you came downstairs. I knew like something's going on, like major things are going on, but it's so, I don't really know. I don't understand. And you had shaved your head and you were wearing a giant white t-shirt, like a men's t-shirt.
Yeah.
And you came downstairs and you sat at the kitchen table and you looked down at the ground and then just your eyes looked up at me. So it was extra scary feeling.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just your eyes looked up and you said, can I share how you what you said?
Yeah, of course.
The beatings start at 2 a.m. And then you described like what you just said.
Yeah.
It's a stab wound to the flank. It's a, like you said this whole series. And I said, I was like, what? What? And then you said it again, exactly the same. Mm-hmm. And so I knew in that moment that this was something that you knew so well that you must have seen it a million times.
Yeah.
And I remember I like put my finger up and I was like, I'm going to call your dad. And you know, in all of this, how would you describe your dad in all of this? Cause I love your dad. Your dad's awesome. So
yeah, my dad's awesome. With us.
Yeah.
He didn't live with us. And so he was very not in the situation.
He just didn't understand.
Yeah. He didn't know about it.
Yeah.
Like at all. Because he wasn't living with me, so he didn't see the everyday struggles.
And I would tell him, but it was like...
It's so horrific that you can't...
Yes.
Imagine it.
It's so horrific that I think he was like, okay, that's like now. And then he would come and see you. And when he would come and see you, it would just be you two. And so you would be okay because you weren't overwhelmed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because really in the middle of all that, you were a sweet, smart kid who read a lot and had interesting conversations and were loving and you cared about people and animals, you know? So like in the middle of all this is like this, you know, on one side, it's like the school version of you and like the, I'm going to say like comparing you to other kids your age and what they're doing and all of that. But then on the other hand, there's this like really amazing human being created in this. Mm-hmm. And so that day when you sat there, I called your dad and I was like, okay, like this is
something's happening.
Something is not like, this is not right.
Yeah.
And then I think from there, it almost feels like a little bit of a blur to me at this point. So like from there, yeah.
I remember we went to Waffle House.
Cause that's what you do when things are hard.
Yeah.
The Waffle House.
I remember we went to Waffle House and you were just in shock eating the entire time. Yeah. And I remember I just told you all the other hallucinations because there were three main ones.
Yeah.
There was the beating of my best friend.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not real. It's okay.
I know.
Think about me eating Waffle House. What did I order? I ordered the cheese and eggs because that's what I would get.
Yeah. And I would eat your hash browns.
Yes. Yes. Because I didn't want to get fat. So it was very, yeah. So you had three main ones and you told me and it was just so unbelievable. Like that's the only way to describe, like unbelievable. Yeah. So like I was, my heart hurt for you. I was suffering for you. I was suffering for me because I was like, I don't understand. Like, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. You don't have to say the other ones if it's.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so we could tap, we could EFT tap that, tap on that.
Okay. I'm okay.
A lot, right. Yeah. We're okay. Yeah. So we tap a lot. This is really why a lot, the reason why I learned a lot of the tools that I share and that I teach my coaching clients is because we went through this. You know, there's a program that I have called The Rise, and I all of the tools in that come from like the things I had to learn to overcome my own personal overwhelm in this situation and the things that I learned to try and help you too.
Yeah.
So I think that's like good can come from these things, even though
it's
horrific, you know?
Yeah.
All right. So we're there in the Waffle House. You're telling me, I can't believe it. So I'm just focused on my eggs.
I remember I was wearing my jean jacket that has flannel lining and I had put spikes in the shoulders.
Do you remember outfits from like important events? Like I remember wearing the moment I found out my mom died. Like I remember like outfits sort of like define my memories of things.
Yeah. I definitely remember my outfit of sitting at that Waffle House and just explaining everything.
Yeah. So there you are telling me all this. And then what do we do?
So that was sort of
sometimes I know we're trying to like explain this in like a way that makes sense. But there's so many little itty bitty pieces that come in to this.
Yeah.
Like you had trauma from the hallucinations. So we had to, at this point, we had to deal with the hallucinations. We had to deal with the medication issue that was the depression and the anxiety. So now there's two issues, but then we also had to deal with, you had PTSD from the hallucinations. So we had to go get, we got EMDR. We did a lot of things right in that to try and to deal with that. So it was like, it was getting bigger.
Yeah. There was so many.
And you weren't going to school. You weren't going to school at that point. The school had come to our house to teach you at home.
Yeah.
But even that was like just a train wreck.
Yeah. Just nothing was working out. Everything, it was so big and there was so much going on and there were so many veins to it.
Yeah.
And it just was awful.
And so what was the tipping point? When did things change?
I think things changed when I moved to my dad's house for a little bit. And that's when he saw how terrible it was.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when he found Hillside.
Mm-hmm.
So, and he, go for it. What were you gonna
say? I was just going to say, so on my side, I was losing it. At this point, I was losing it. And I got up really early one day and I was in my office. I remember I was in my, because I remember outfits. I was in that fuzzy bathrobe I used to have that Dad had for Christmas. And I had my coffee and I was looking out the front window and I had been having periods of time over like maybe 3 weeks before where I was starting to feel outside my body. Mm-hmm. And so like when things would happen with you, because there was a lot happening, it wasn't like this was happening like in isolation, like in the middle of the night, like there was a lot of tension and like drama and fighting in a lot of ways too, because I didn't understand and you couldn't explain it. And I wanted somebody to explain it to me. I didn't know what to do. Yeah. I was mad at everybody for not helping me. Nobody could see it. I started to feel very disconnected from my body as if I was outside of my body. Mm-hmm. And so this particular Saturday morning, I was sitting there drinking my coffee and I was feeling that. And I felt like I've got to lay on the floor. I have to lay on the floor. And so I laid down on the floor in my office. And I remember feeling like I can't get up. Like I can't get up. It's not safe for me to get off the floor, and to the point where it's not safe for me to move my cheek off the floor, you know?
Yeah.
So like when I look back, like I was having a complete disassociative episode, like the beginning of PTSD, acute stress disorder is what I was diagnosed with. And so I remember thinking I wanted to just move. I wanted to go to Africa. And I think I texted my sister and said, I think I need to go to Africa. Well, I mean, I don't know what, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
And Craig came in, my husband, Craig came in and said, what do we need to do? And I said, you need to call Chris. That's your dad.
Yeah.
You need to call Chris. He needs to come here. He needs to take her. Like, I can't do this anymore. And in the meantime, like over the few weeks or months before, I mean, I had spent a lot of time hiding in my closet because it was so overwhelming. Like, do you know what I mean? So there's a lot going on in all of this for everybody. And so he called Chris and left a message. And that's when Dad came and got you.
Yep.
So Dad came and got you. He had you for, he was supposed to have you for a week. He had you for like 2 days.
Yeah.
And he called me and he's like, why didn't you tell me? Oh my God.
Yeah, and I was like, so sick.
And I was like, oh my God, I've been telling people for years, years. Nobody's listening to me. Nobody's listening to me. And so that's really when we got like, we went, well, no, actually that's not when you went to Hillside. That's when we brought you to the doctor, to the hospital.
Yes. Yes. I went to the hospital.
Can we talk about that?
Yeah, of course.
I'm trying to decide, was that day that I called Dad and Dad came to get you, I think that's the day we brought you to the hospital. I don't think that's the day you went and lived with Dad for.
Yeah, I think we went to the hospital first. We went to the hospital and they were like, what are you feeling? And I was like, I feel like I'm going to kill myself.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh, that's not good. So they put me in a mental institution called Laurelwood.
They took you away that day from the hospital. Like it was out of the state basically took you. And I remember they put you in a truck with like armed guards.
Yep. They put me in a van.
In like a cage, like in the back of the van.
Yeah. There was like a cage in the back of the van. It was padded and it looked outward. So there was a chair in the van and it would look outward. So when they were driving, I could look at the cars that were behind this van.
Oh, and right. Yeah. Yeah.
There were like windows. And
tap, tap, tap. It's painful. It's painful to think about because it brings you right back to it, which really shows you how powerful you are, that you can bring yourself back to sadness, which means you can also bring yourself right back to happiness. Yeah. Right? You're super powerful. Super powerful. And you can't see her right now, but she's just tapping. Because that's how we reprogram our subconscious, right? We can reprogram our nervous system by doing this. So it's really powerful. And I love that you go right to that. I love you so much. You're such a special human being. And having gone through this and being brave enough to talk about it, it really, you know, sometimes it's like, well, how is this going to help anybody? But just hearing the story will help other people recognize it earlier for their kids, maybe.
Yeah.
Right? Like there's so much good. You have so many good things to offer to the world. I'm so grateful you're here and that you chose to stay here with your hippy dippy mother.
I remember I sang a Gregory and the Hawk song to myself on the way to the hospital.
In the van. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember that was like, so they took you and I remember it was a 48-hour hold.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I had to get you clothes that had no strings. You had to take all the shoelaces out of your shoes. Like, I remember being like so worried about you.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what was going on. And then on my end, I was on one hand, like, this is the saddest, worst thing that's ever happened. It feels so scary. I don't know what's going on. And the second part of it was, I was so happy to have relief and to have, to know somebody was watching you all the time. And so I could rest, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I remember my sister who lives in Seattle reached out and she said, what can I do? I'm here in Seattle. Like, what can I do? What can I do? Yeah. Yeah. And I remember I said, I need to get a massage so that I can move this emotion through my body. Like, it didn't feel like I need to go get to the spa. Like, it wasn't that. Yeah. It was like, I need therapeutic touch to like move me through this. Yeah. And she did. She immediately like scheduled me a massage and I just went and I was like a zombie. It felt like a zombie land.
Yeah.
And it did. And I cried during the massage and it helped so much.
That's good.
Yeah. But meanwhile, you're in there and the thing I hate about that experience, there was a good thing from my view. There was a good thing and a bad thing that came from that. Maybe mm-hmm. all of it was good because it was a learning. But one is yeah. they got you on daytime schedule because you had been mm-hmm. sleeping all day and gotten after you had had those hallucinations, you got in a pattern.
Yeah.
Sleeping during the day and being awake all night.
Mm-hmm.
And that didn't stop. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
Like that, they got you on that schedule. And when I tried to get you on that schedule, you'd get really angry because you were, I mean, you were so tired, you know?
Yeah, like I was exhausted.
So it was like, you just would get really, really angry. So it was like, you didn't want to shake the tree. You know what I mean? You just wanted peace. And if you had some peace because you were sleeping during the day, then it was almost like a relief. So we were like letting you do that.
Yeah.
So when you went there, they didn't care. They put you on they made you stay up all day.
Yeah.
You were tired at night. And so that was a really good thing that came out of it.
Yeah.
The other thing is they put you immediately on medication, which was the same class of medication that gave you the horrific
nightmares, hallucinations, whatever you want to call them.
And so I was so mad about it. And so like the day you came out, I just took you off it.
Yeah. And because your doctor friend was like, no way, Jose.
Right. She was like, that's the same class of medication. Like they get put on something else if they're going to do that. So I had called the EMDR lady who was really like holistic-y. I liked her a lot.
Yeah. She was really great.
Mm-hmm. And I said, this is what's happened. What do I do? Like, I just need to know what to do. And she said, have you ever had her diagnosed? And I was like, well, I brought it to a million doctors. Like, if nobody's diagnosed her, like, so then the weird thing was at that point, I did bring you somewhere and got you diagnosed. It was a misdiagnosis, but again, it was a gift.
Got us closer.
Because it got us it got us moving in the right direction.
Yeah.
So there was a whole bunch of other little things that have happened in the middle of all of that. And then we found Hillside.
Yes. Hillside was basically they had, you know, you could go for months and just stay there and live there. Mm-hmm. It's for people 18 and younger, and they would just keep you there, or you could go to this day program, which is what I did. So I would go during the day, then I would go home at night. And how long was I there?
You did a 6-week program there or eight, okay. something like that. But that's why we had you live with daddy, because dad lived right near there.
Yeah. Dad lived right next to it, like right near it. And so I stayed with him and I stayed at Hillside during the day and then go home at night.
And within like a week of being there, you were feeling better.
Yeah.
Like it was remarkable. Like the first week was bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The first week was bad. Second week was okay. And then all the weeks after that was really good.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they did DBT therapy there.
Yes. DBT, dialectical behavior therapy. Which we had tried that in two other places. Remember we came to Buckhead to the DBT center. We had tried some of that, but it wasn't in this like intense all day, everything DBT.
Yeah. Yes.
And the whole way they did it was just so helpful. And then we had family therapy also.
Yes. So we would do family therapy. I had art therapy. I was there with a bunch of other kids who had similar stories. And they all were so
alone.
Yeah, it was really comforting to have all these other kids who were like, we're all so messed up.
Yeah. And then you were like, I'm not as messed up as a lot of people.
Yeah. And it was nice having friends.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you started to come back to who Olive is. And it's making you cry a little bit because of COVID's like, we don't have friends again because COVID. It's hard right now. So in all of that, then you came out of that and you decided, I don't want to go back to high school. Like, I don't want to go back into that environment. I want to move forward. And so you got your GED and, you know, they'll make you take GED classes, whatever. It takes like 6 months or whatever. And you were like,
how do you know all this?
How do I know all this?
No, I was like, I already know all this.
Oh yeah. You were like, I already know. I was like, I was there. Yeah. You were like, I know all this. You took the test in like 2 weeks and passed everything. Cause you're smart. You're a reader. Like, and I think like school was difficult. It was the structure of school, but you were smart and you love to read and learn stuff. Mm-hmm. And like, I don't know. So you came through it. You got your GED. Yep. You still don't have your license at that point, but within like a month or two, we got your license.
Yep.
And now what?
And now I'm doing really good. I'm in college. Mm-hmm. I'm currently at Georgia State University.
Yep. You're going to try to transfer to SCAD.
SCAD, trying to transfer to SCAD.
If anybody knows anybody, let us know.
Yeah, if you know anyone, let us know.
Because you're an artist.
Yes, and I draw every day, and I'm doing really well.
And what's your big dream?
I want to be a tattoo artist.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's the final goal.
Yeah. So I love it. So you got your own apartment, you're going to school, you're feeling really good. You have good days and bad days, but just like everyone else's days. And now when you look back at that journey, what do you think?
I'm really grateful for Hillside. That's like
the big thing. That's like the big thing. They changed your life.
Yeah, they really did.
They really did. And you still see a doctor from Hillside.
Yeah.
So you keep that peace.
Yeah. And he's great. He's perfect for me.
Yeah. He's very cool because he and I read the same books. Like he's right.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. I like him a lot too. Yeah, so
he's super cool.
Which Olive's like, sometimes I'm like, can I go with you to go see him? She's like, no, it's my doctor. I'm like, okay, like, I can see what books he has on his coffee table. He might have new ones. I need to know what they are. So when you look back now at that time, does it seem like somebody else? Like that seems so different from who you are.
It does. It doesn't seem like it happened to me entirely.
Yeah.
It feels very disconnected.
Yeah. Cause you're so
like, I don't even remember a lot of what happened in the way that memories are usually. Like I know what happened, but it feels like when you look at a picture of yourself when you were like 3 and your parents are like, oh, that was at this house and this is what you did. Yeah. And it's like, oh, now I know that that's what I did, but I don't really remember it through the scope of my own eyes.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. A lot has changed. A lot is different. So what would be your advice to someone who is going through this or has gone through this in their life?
It really does get better.
Yeah.
You got to just keep fighting for it and keep working on it. And just every day, even if the next day sucks, it'll be better than the last.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you're just going to keep getting better and better and everything's going to be okay.
Yeah. I remember when you were really sick, I used to tell you, I promise you it gets better. This isn't it. Like I promise you. And I would make you promise that you wouldn't leave me. Cause I was like, I won't be able to do it.
Yeah.
I would lose my mind.
Yeah.
And I think part of what kept you around is cause you didn't want to do that to me.
Yeah, no, for sure. I think the two things that kept me around were you and the cat.
Yeah. The cat. We got you a therapy cat and he's the best.
Yeah, we got me a therapy cat and I got him when I was like 12 and I was like, he would be really sad without me. So I can't go anywhere.
Yeah, exactly. He would be very sad. When she went to Hillside, he stayed with me and he was so mad. He was so mad.
He would pee on the couch.
He would pee on the couch. It was so disgusting. I got rid of that couch, but I was like, I can't, like this cat is, he was like having withdrawals, you know, I was like, you've got to have the cat. So then we brought him back over to dad's and he was so happy, even though he had to stay in your room. He didn't care. He just was like, this is so great.
Yeah.
I'm really, really proud of you.
Thank you.
You've come a long, long way. And I think it's just a testament to like perseverance and support. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And not giving up.
And finding the right help.
Yes. Not giving up.
There's going to be a lot of like not great doctors before you find a really great one.
Yeah.
Just keep pushing to find. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And for moms or caregivers, you know, dads, whoever, I would say, like, don't forget your own mental health in this. Yeah. I learned a lot and learned that I had to really take care of myself. And in a lot of ways, I mean, it was a blessing for me in a lot of ways too, because it really made me, one of the things I remember was that it made me get really, really clear on not having outside circumstances control my internal happiness. Mm-hmm. And I remember there was a time period, and I don't want to jump back because I know we're kind of closing up.
Yeah, yeah.
Time period where it was hard for you to not hurt yourself in that. Yeah. And mm-hmm. I would have to help and stop you and mm-hmm. maintain happiness while that was happening. Yeah. And I remember that being a practice for me. Like, this is my training ground to learn how to maintain happiness, even in the midst of chaos and terrible, like the most terrible you could think of. Like when I talk a lot about my mom dying on the show and stuff, like it's a big part of my life. What happened with you was 19 times worse, like so much worse, so much worse. And there's still healing to go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for coming on the show.
Yeah, of course.
I love you so much. I'm grateful you're my daughter. Thanks for picking me to come into this world and do this with.
Yeah, of course.
All right. Thanks for being here, Olive. Bye-bye.
Yeah. Bye.
Thank you so much for being here and for listening to today's episode. If you liked it and got something out of it, please be sure to share with me by leaving a review over on iTunes. And if you're not following on social media, I am everywhere at Betsy Paik, but most of the time over on Instagram. So follow and comment on my latest post so that we can connect there. I'll see you next week. And until then, keep living big.